welcome our next speaker. François Le, thank you very much for coming. As you told us, it's your first time at the Isle of Openness conference, but it's your second time in Malta. Okay, so welcome. François specializes in software innovation as entrepreneur, independent contractor, board member for non-profit, lecturer, and author. He has 20 years of hands-on executive experience in corporate strategy, open source communities, innovation ecosystems, both in the public and the private sector. François is also director of Cluster Elite, a regional cluster of over 300 software companies in France, and also executive director of Object Web, open source movement. Welcome.
Share three references. What I've done on purpose with that with now presentations, we share three references. So I'd like to start with the challenge in the room so to keep people away during my presentation. So if you find the three references, I'm happy to offer you a beer during the premiere on the right. I also have another challenge for you. Is that anyone know nice template which I used for this presentation? Well, it actually is one of the basic OpenOffice templates, so I'd like to use it over and over again to make it very explicit that I have been in open source business for a couple of years. Some may say it's a step on fashion, but I like it this way. Alright, so I have to now find out how it works. So, openness. We've been here about openness for about 30 years in the software business. We can remember open systems, for instance, back in the early 80s. Then we went through open systems, open source software, we went through open data, open standards, open government, open well, just about open everything. With people even claiming that the future itself is open, so this is a nice claim. But the question is actually, what does open mean? And I remember a panel session during the open source think tank last year, where the question was, what does open mean to you? And the answer was pretty intriguing. Well, open innovation, at least one person, it takes some time to define open innovation. But the first person who did that was Henry Chesbrough. Actually wrote books about open innovation, or they give you with the written books. I just keep three items which I think are very important in the definition of open innovation. The first thing is to make firm boundaries more favorable to innovation. This is, I would say, what you may imagine when thinking of the concept of open innovation. Open innovation, so making innovation flow through. The third item is actually making partnerships between all different kinds of players, academic, enterprises, companies, even individual people. And I let the one in the middle for the end because it is what makes more sense, in my opinion, for the open source community. So open innovation is based on open innovation intermediaries. People in the middle of different players can source innovation here and deliver it there. So it makes sense, for instance, for all different kinds of strong IP, such as patents, people source the patents, you know, and then deliver patents to others. But also in the software world, well, actually, we can see that the open source code bases are open source intermediaries. Okay, so you may imagine a code base as a kind of bus, innovation bus, where people can contribute innovation, and then other people can find innovation and use innovation where they need it. And this is a mechanism which is suited to all different kinds of players, academia, the private sector, individuals, etc. So we see that open source process is a very nice example of innovation in the real world. which I know very well because I actually was the director of ObjectWeb between 2004 and 2007. ObjectWeb was an open source community which had the nice idea of being born and raised in Europe. ObjectWeb is still alive, but the name changed. That was called OWW2. And ObjectWeb is basically a scope and a process. The scope is middleware, all different kinds of middleware, mostly Java-based middleware, but all different kinds of middleware, and a process which is open source. Open source with governance. The nice thing is ObjectWeb is that the players who contribute to the project are not only individuals but also companies. So companies can actually find a way to steer the direction of the code base according to the process that are familiar with, which is being involved into a very strict governance model, which is compatible with the decision process inside the company. And the production is a code base. The code base of ObjectWeb was about 130 projects at the end of 2007. Now we don't really have about projects who are not so active, and now there are maybe around 100 projects. And something like anywhere between 50 to 100 legal entity members. Oh, I was supposed to have a diagram here, but actually it did not work on the computer there, so I will just explain with words the idea. The idea of the code base of ObjectWeb is that there were many different projects, mostly led by companies which were different from one project to another. So it was basically like a mapping project company. And the license, the choice of license was free, as long as it was compliant with the OSI rules. LGPL was recommended. So it was like a jigsaw puzzle of projects. Some complementary or overlapping. It's pretty loosely coupled. And it turned out to be a very efficient open innovation model with 2,000 individuals involved. As I said, hundreds of projects, hundreds of tens of billions of lines of code, and nice output such as J2E, Java Enterprise Edition, Server, etc. Another example is the JDB, right, community, which I will not document in detail. The only idea is here to show you that there is a whole set of different open source projects and also versions which derive from one method to another. And this is a good example of a very thriving community with a lot of innovation which is going on year after year. Okay, so now a couple of data traps that are very common when going the open source way. Well, these comments come from my own experience as a freelance consultant. Well, I worked with a lot of small companies which were not all very familiar with open source. And the common pitfalls are first to suffer from the NIH syndrome, which you know very well, we're not invented here syndrome, which basically is to say, okay, we are the smartest people in the world, or maybe we just don't even ask the question. And we don't waste time to find out what other people did for me to answer the questions that we have, the difficulties that we face. The second pitfall is to go the open source way by saying, okay, now we start a great project and everybody will collaborate with us. This is great, but actually there are a lot of projects around already. And we cannot all lead our own project. We have to join the other projects first, to then be able to decide when it makes sense at some point to say, okay, this area is not covered yet, we will start a new project, but we have to first And the third pitfall is the lies and incompatibilities, which is actually something which is, well, at least as complex as software incompatibility, or more complex. And this is something which oftentimes is just beyond the imagination of developers. They're just, well, they want this for example is great, you know, because, well, it's free. It's more free than other tools. It's say LGPL, 33, HTTPL, etc. It's real free software. And it actually paves the way to a lot of problems. Okay, an interesting remark is that actually today more than 80% of closed source, I would say, commercial software include open source elements. Sometimes it's even closed source software because it includes open source components, which are the permissive license that can be, you know, closed and delivered as commercial open source software. To understand that there are a lot of opportunities in the business world with open source, I try to map different business models and make a small diagram. So I will not go through the whole diagram. The idea is to say, okay, if you consider open source projects and if you are realistic and decide that you can only sell things that you own, you have to find things that you own that you can sell to customers. And oftentimes, it's not the open source project. Because the open source project is free, open, licensed, and there are terms that makes it available to other people. So you don't own the project as such, even if you own the rights, the IP rights. So you have to find things that you can sell, and the idea is to say there are three kinds of things you can sell. Complement, substitute, or supersets of open source. And most oftentimes, the thing you said is not the project itself. And this answers the question that is very common. A very common question is, how can you people in the open source world make profit with free products? Well, actually, the product is not the project itself, so it makes sense because you sell something else. Example, the AR drone, which is actually, think of it as a remote control drone. This drone is actually a hardware that you can buy, and it's powered with open source software, and actually, provided with the open source SDK, so you can actually modify the drone, modify the software, and develop your own innovative concept. And research that, use RR drone, for instance, to experiment with it. Another example is actually mobile phone. So I have an Android phone here, which is obviously open source design. But in iPhone, you also have a lot of open source software embedded things. You have the Mac operating system, you have Cocoa is to some extent open too, and etc. etc. Then the point here is to let you understand that open source can actually be used to make products which are not open, and an open innovation process also can deliver products which are not open. Okay, so if you don't sell the open source code base, if you don't sell the open source software or the project as such, you have to be in control of what you sell. There is a red flag in companies, especially in smaller companies, which is to have a fear of losing control over the line of the product and also the company itself. Control. Control means, well, what about software quality? If you go open source, you know, anybody can contribute to the code base, what about software quality? Competitive advantages. Okay, my competitor can use my code base and I actually deliver the same product as I do. Bring that image. If I open my source code, everybody in the world will see that we actually code in a way which is not exactly compliant with the school book. Legal liability. Is there any code that I borrowed from an open source project without even actually tracking it? What if people go to me and claim that we stole that code without knowing it? And leadership. If we're starting a project and turn out to be not good enough, and someone else jump in and say, okay, I'm going to be the next project leader, we'll lose leadership. And the answer to this is actually to go the open source way without going the open innovation way. And I have an example here, which is a company where all this is public information. Then deliver a product line, which is called Wakanda. It's actually advertised as open source. So you can go to GitHub and watch. Look at them, the team which is behind Wakanda, and then it's quite interesting. I have the name here. But Wakanda is actually proposed under a different set of licenses, some are closed license, some proprietary software, and then we have a part of Wakanda which is proposed as community edition under the GPL3 and AGPL license. So now let's have a look to the team, which is behind Wakanda. There are 10 people, and actually, if you look at the titles, you can see that one is the architect of 4D, one is the engineer at 4D, the director, right? All the people in Wakanda work actually at 4D, which is companies called 4D. So it's open source with a very close team, and the development process is controlled by the person by the company. Interesting to notice here that they choose licenses which are actually often seen as the more free, the freer licenses in the world. AGPL and GPL is free, are more in line with the ethics of free software. And you can spot projects on the whole spectrum of open source licenses. So we have the more permissive on the left, MIT, and the more strongly copyrighted on the right, AGPL, etc. And you see here that a lot of projects actually, which are to some extent connected to cloud technology, use AGPL license and actually use AGPL license to prevent people to use them. So they use the open source license and choose the license so that people do not reuse that license. I discovered this video on the web. It's a great question on YouTube. And it's an ad from BlackDuck, which explained that. So there is a legal threat behind it by using AGPL or GPL's proprietary license. These companies actually threaten people in some way that if you reuse and actually do what the open source processes is supposed to be, if you do that, well, you may be not sued for that. So, other ways to prevent collaboration is code obfuscation. So, code obfuscation, you actually deliver code under the open source license. But to make sure that no one can understand what you are doing, you put no comments, you use a weird name or whatever. So, it's open source letter within the spirit. Tribalization, well, actually, the word may not be so good, but the idea is to combine open source software with hardware and make sure that this hardware can only run a certain version of the open source software, so you cannot just modify software and run open hardware. And that's a link between this version of software and this specific hardware. And to have a closed team, so no right here, button, and the X axis we have the level of open sourceness, I would say. And on the Y axis you have the work of open innovation. And back in the day, classic ISV have been in the bottom left part of the diagram, and in the opposite quarter here at right, you have the ideal of open source companies with an open innovation process, licenses which are compatible with collaboration, innovation, etc. And I've discovered that most vendors actually are able to make one step, so to modify their strategy, either to go open source or to start an open innovation process. But it's much more difficult for them to make two steps. And it may actually destroy their business altogether, going from proprietary to open source companies is a gap which is almost impossible to make for at least one. Well, that's it. A couple of takeaways. Well, in my opinion, Flock is one of the best examples of open innovation. You may have open innovation processes which lead to proprietary products. You may have actually your equivalent cross players who build cross software on a closed innovation process. And when making steps from closed either source or innovation to fully open, the tendency, the desire for control, it actually comes out productive because it makes company stick to the letter but not to the spirit of open source and therefore open innovation. Well, I think that's all. Yep.
You made a comment about consolidating licenses when you work with you and actually fixing incompatibility of the software. You made a comment about comparing the problems between fixing software incompatibility and fixing license. Fixing software is a go forward thing. So you buy the fix, you roll it out, problems come. Is there something like that in the license world? Can you ever go back and undo what you did before?
Well, from my experience, it's more compatible because of the also because of the people we have to deal with, actually. There are different orientations in the both code and licenses are kind of contracts in a way. But in the on the developer side, that is this will to always to go forward and how to put this to get rid of stumbling blocks. Whereas when you have to deal with license compatibility, you have to deal with the other departments in the company. And they are not very prone to, they're very eager to redesign and go through the whole process again when they didn't have the project works. So,
even if they would, let's assume you can manage that, and yeah, you get everyone on board to change your life, it's still possible that months ago your code was used in previous months that you would never be able to hunt out.
Well, I had examples where we could actually change license for some countries, but very, very critical. Not for the versions, right?
Yeah, so you have your open source out there with the license as it was, right? At some point you realize, oh boy, I should have done this differently.
Yeah.
Right? And someone used the version from before. There's no way to go back and
fix that. Actually, that was, yeah. I had two examples. One, when you going from very permissive license to less permissive license. And it was for running the dual license business model. So they realized that with very permissive license, this open source, this dual license would not work.
Yeah.
So they changed the license, but had to change it with a major version. So from version 2 to version 3, they changed the license of the data. And another example is a project from a student who put the project under a GPL license just because and we discovered this project was key to a whole set of different applications, which meant we licensed under a very promising license. So we had to negotiate and actually have this person, like one person, change the license, which was possible. So it could work, but it's easier when it's not about a huge community with many different contributors.
Thank you. Any more questions from the audience? No? Okay, so, okay. Thank you very much.
We haven't regarded the report. I don't think your software and that's both my favorite. It was
have a fine do not for that one. Thank you very much.